Paris has always been a magnet for tourists, but also for great stories and the people who love to hear them. Think about it. It's home to the Hunchback of Notre Dame, the Revolution, Napoleon and Josephine. But recently it's been gripped by an even greater story, the hunt for the Holy Grail.
How many people know at any one time where the Holy Grail is hidden?
Four.
Thought by many to be the very cup from which Jesus drank at the Last Supper, the Holy Grail has haunted our imagination for centuries, but left us with unanswered questions. Does the Grail exist or not? And what is it?
You're now telling me the Holy Grail is in your perfume shop down the road.
That's it.
Well, I'm going on a 5,000-mile journey to find out.
Cute.
It's a quest that will bring me to ancient scrolls in the Vatican's secret archive, medieval knights and hidden treasure in the south of France, relics in Constantinople.
That sounds pretty fantastic. I mean, are these genuine?
It's a story that was 2,000 years in the making, and the BBC, bless them, have given me just 2 weeks to search for the Holy Grail. So, I better get on with it, right? We're told that 2,000 years ago, Jesus, knowing he'd been betrayed and would soon face crucifixion, gathered together his disciples for what we call the Last Supper. If you believe your standard Grail story, it has the Grail as the cup or chalice used by Jesus at that Last Supper in Jerusalem. It was supposed to have magical powers and was the most important religious relic in the Western world. But what happened to it? Well, it was seen by pilgrims in the 5th century, but then it disappears from Palestine. By the 13th century, it was claimed that the Grail was held by the people of Constantinople. So that is where my quest begins. Istanbul is a fascinating city. It's a stunning mix of old and new, of east and west, and has always been a major center for trade.
Wow. Is this all Turkish delight?
Right. South.
What's this made with?
But 800 years ago, at the time of the Christian Crusades, it was even more impressive. 8 times the size of Paris, it was the biggest and most impressive city in the Western world. It was also the center of a booming trade in religious relics. I'm on the Bosphorus, and it is a remarkable place. On that side, Asia. On this side, Europe. During the Crusades, tens of thousands of knights making their way to and from the Holy Land would have come here. So this narrow division, it's only, what, 800 yards wide, marked the line between not just two continents, but two completely different worlds. This is Istanbul. Before that, it was called Constantinople, and before that, Byzantium. And it's long been associated with important religious relics. And it makes a sort of sense, because knights coming back with relics from the Holy Land would have come through here. So, at various times, pieces of the one true cross, the crown of thorns, John the Baptist's bones are all supposed to have ended up here. Constantinople was at the center of the early expansion of Christianity, and there are plenty of tales about holy relics being brought here. What I need to find out is if the greatest relic of all, the Holy Grail, was amongst them. The local church seemed like a good place to start. Hagia Sophia was built in the 6th century by Emperor Justinian as a Christian church because Byzantium at the time rivaled Rome as one of the key centres of early Christianity. And this was built to reflect that, to impress. So only the best materials were used in here, yellow and white marble. And it was lavishly decorated throughout with magnificent Christian murals and wall hangings and gilt and silver carvings. But above all else, there was the scale. It is massive. In fact, for 1,000 years, this was the biggest enclosed space on the planet. It was, and it still is, awesome. For 1,500 years, people have been passing through this place, and they've left their mark on it in all sorts of ways. This is the Weeping Column, and people believe that putting your thumb here and turning your hand around like that will mean your prayer, perhaps for a cure, will be answered. And look,
a hole has been worn in solid marble just by the action of thumbs like that. How many thumbs did that take?
800 years ago, during the Crusades, this church was dripping with some of the world's most precious and important religious relics. Could the Holy Grail have been among them? I met up with Tom Asbridge. Tom is a leading historian on the Crusades. If anyone knows, he will.
It's huge. Constantinople was famous as one of the greatest sites of collection of relics in the world. Why they came here is partly to do with how important Constantinople was as a center for the church, and also to do with Byzantium's wealth. They were able to buy these things, attract them to this center point. And what happened over the period of 600-700 years is that some of the greatest relics in the known world began to sort of congregate here and were in various key collections, either in the Byzantine Imperial Palace or in Hagia Sophia, the key church. So what we've got here are some of the most important Christian relics that are still in Istanbul, in Constantinople. And these are possibly still the medieval relics that were here at the time of the Crusades in the medieval period. We've got here in this arm what's technically called a reliquary, the box or the thing that holds a relic. We've got bones from the arm of John the Baptist. And in this other box here, we've got a piece of his skull.
So they would have been displayed then in the church or altar, wherever they were kept. They would have been there on display for people to come and see, just as we are now.
They had the greatest things that you could see anywhere on earth. They had the crown of thorns. They supposedly had the lance that had pierced the side of Christ on the cross. Things that had been intimately connected with Christ were here, and you could see them.
So does it stand up? If there were a grail, would it have come here?
I think, given the fact that Constantinople had so many other relics associated with Christ, the crown of thorns, the holy lance, the shroud, if there was such a thing as a holy grail, it's possible that that relic could have passed through Constantinople or been held in Constantinople.
This place is amazing. I've never seen anything like it. And the collection of relics here is incredible too. But of course, at the time of the Crusades, Constantinople itself was crammed with relics from all over the world. So it does make sense. If the Grail was a relic, then this was the place it would have ended up. Though not necessarily permanently, because most of the relics were taken from Constantinople by the Crusaders and distributed throughout Europe, and the Grail possibly amongst them.
Well, Istanbul has been fascinating to visit. There's a real sense of history to the place. A lot of important and fascinating things happened here. And I'd love to spend a bit longer finding out more about it, but I can't. Time is against me, and I've got to move on. The big question is, where to next? Because from here, the Grail becomes the subject of a whole host of stories about where it went. Some believe that it went west to Spain. Others think France. Then others believe it went north to Britain. So I'm at a real fork in the roads here. I've got to make my mind up, and it's not easy. Fortunately, there is an ancient Turkish custom to help you out in just such circumstances. It's called heads or tails. So, heads west, tails north. Well, I shan't be needing my sun cream. I'm going north.
I'm following the trail of one particular group of Crusaders called the Knights Templar, and it's taken me back to England.
It was easy in Istanbul, ancient meeting place of Europe and Asia, with its stories of Crusader knights, to peer back through the mists of time and conjure up images of the Holy Grail and the knights who might have brought it back from their adventures in the Holy Land. It's a bit more difficult now, swapped the Bosphorus for the Thames here on London's busy Victoria Embankment. But just over there, behind those trees, in a sort of maze of ancient buildings, there's a church, and it's a little piece of Jerusalem.
Temple Church was built by the Knights Templar, who, according to legend, were the guardians of the Grail. They were founded in 1118 and were based in Jerusalem, near the site where Jesus died.
Their job was to protect pilgrims on their way to and from the Holy Land.
It was a dangerous business being a pilgrim. The destination of every pilgrim was, of course, Jerusalem, and within Jerusalem, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, supposedly the site of Christ's own death, burial, and rising, was the ultimate destination. It was the centre of the world. And the Church of the Holy Sepulchre is round. And wherever the Knights Templar went, they would build, as part of their headquarters, a church such as this, which was designed to recreate the sanctity of Holy Sepulchre.
So that's why it's rare.
That's right.
So, some of these Knights Templar come back to London and they build this. Now, these are effigies of some of them, are they?
That's right. These are knights, one of whom here actually did take the cross, surrounded by his three sons. The important thing to remember about effigies such as these is the knights are shown, do you see, the knights are shown with their eyes open. They're shown in their 30s, whatever the age at which they actually died, because Christ died in his 30s, and it was believed that that was the age at which he would bring the dead back to life.
So this is as close as we can possibly get to meeting a knight. This is what they would have looked like.
He was buried here. He was actually buried here. He had been out to the Holy Land on crusade as a young man, and he had brought back a shroud as a young man in which he wanted to be buried when eventually he died.
If there were the faintest clank of metal right now, I would expect them
they'd
to
be
off. Right.
They'd,
yeah, I would be expecting
off.
To
that's
see
absolutely.
That.
That's right.
They're immensely moving. They would have strode in through that door. And we can only imagine that you'd have knights sitting there in chapter, in consultation. This is where the knights would have met.
Ranked around
they
the
would
room.
Have been. You could just imagine them ranked around these walls.
I so want to believe that. That's a stunning image, isn't it?
Yes.
So we have this amazing place with its direct physical connections with the Holy Land, with the Knights Templar coming back from the Holy Land, bringing things with them to here.
Yes.
Do you think they brought the Grail?
Ah, no.
Here?
No, I don't think they brought the Grail.
It's not.
No, I'm afraid it's not just tucked in underneath there. No,
right.
Not at all.
So it's not here. But this isn't the only church that links the Knights Templar with the Holy Grail and these islands, because there is a church in Scotland that claims they brought the Grail there. So that's where I'm going next, Edinburgh. I'm heading to Rosslyn near Edinburgh. It's a long way from Constantinople and the Holy Land. But a lot of people believe that the Knights Templar brought the Grail here and that a mysterious church was built to hide it in, Rosslyn Chapel. Well, I feel as if I've spent almost as much time the Knights Templar as I have the Grail itself. They've become so interwoven. Both have led me here, Rosslyn Chapel, supposedly the place where they hid the Grail itself, somewhere in or around this structure. Could be walking over it right now. Built in the 15th century by Sir William St. Clair, Rosslyn Chapel is a sort of temple to medieval bling. Over 70,000 people visit it every year.
So the masons at the time, the building would be about this height.
The story goes that the Knights Templar brought the Holy Grail to Scotland. The chapel was then built as a secret hiding place, and that clues to the whereabouts of the Grail were hidden in the famed medieval carvings. Renee is with a group of American tourists. She's a psychic and has helped the police with missing person cases.
The Grail tour business is seriously booming. It's a German tour going on at the moment. There are clues everywhere. Look, I found one here. Even I can tell. These stones don't quite match these stones. Well, there's a theory that the whole building is actually as deep as it is high, and that underneath is an enormous vault, and this supposedly is an entrance to it. I mean, you could get any number of grails in there, no matter how big they are.
You'll feel a sensation, maybe I should put it that way.
but like for me, I feel it in the ground and it comes up from my legs and it just goes up sort of up your body and kind of out the top of your head.
Or even now?
Yeah, you can feel it coming in this way and different directions also.
So
it's very powerful. When I get into a really good state, I can see a golden light comes down from the ceiling.
I'll let you know. Forget that, right?
Yeah, then you're really tuning in.
Well, I'll leave you to go and feel it, and I'll go and feel it over here. Thank you, Annie. There's another guided tour going around right now, and this place is absolutely dripping with tales of treasures and relics and grails. Like this, one of the big theories is around this. It's called the Apprentice Pillar, and it was carved, supposedly, by an apprentice whose master was away. When the master got back, he was so jealous of the amazing quality of this workmanship that he killed the apprentice. But the theory is that the grail is inside this pillar. Another one runs that it's actually in the floor underneath. Well, they won't let me knock the pillar down and find out, but it looks like somebody might have had a go at the floor already.
I searched all afternoon, but the only cup I found was in a stained glass window. I'd followed the trail of the Knights Templar and felt sure they would bring me to the Grail. But Ian Robertson was about to burst that bubble.
I don't understand. The Knights Templar got out of the Middle East with something. They came here and then supposedly they hid it and they built this to hide it.
They never. The Order of the Temple was suppressed way before this was built. This was certainly built by a knight, a 15th century knight, but not a Knights Templar. And again, only in the last 20 years, stories of the Templars building Roslyn have grown up, but based on no historical facts.
So I've followed the wrong trail for the Knights Templar. I've come to the wrong place. Whatever they brought with them out of the Middle East is
they
not
didn't
buried
bring it
under
here.
Roslyn.
No.
Right. So now what? Where do I go now?
The Knights Templar have let me down, but hunting the Grail is like that. You think you're onto something and then you're not. So I want to get right back to the stories that fascinated me as a kid. It's got to be King Arthur and the Holy Grail, and for that, it's got to be Glastonbury.
So, Glastonbury next. Glastonbury really does seem to be a magnet for all manner of legends and mystery, particularly the Arthurian legends, and I love all of that. I mean, King Arthur and his knights and the Round Table and Excalibur, all of that. As a kid, it was just irresistible, the idea of heroism and chivalry and bravery and honour. You can't resist that as a kid. This is it then. Dusty and weary from the trail. Arriving Glastonbury. Magnet. Centuries for people believing in all manner of things. Mystical powers, psychic powers, magical stones, Arthurian legends. A lot of them bonkers, obviously, but a lot of them very sincere in what they believe. It also makes it quite difficult to park, which is annoying.
Excuse me, sorry, can I just ask you, I'm making a documentary for the BBC, actually on the Holy Grail, which is what's brought me here, but what's brought everybody else here?
Crop circles.
Right.
Oh, the...
Yeah.
All of this?
Yes, all of this.
It's a three-day crop circle symposium.
Is it?
Yes, it is.
What do you do in a three-day crop circle symposium?
Very good question, I've never been before.
Really?
It's my first experience.
So as I'm making a documentary on the Holy Grail, do you have a view on the Holy Grail?
I don't like anything if it's religious connotations.
If I just call it the
spiritual.
Grail?
Spiritual.
Well,
yes, your own grail, your own needs for life, your own love of life.
Not a cup, then?
Are you looking for something physical, or are you working on... What level are you working on?
I don't know.
You can work on the physical. We're looking for a cup. You can work on the mental, on the spiritual. Does it matter?
Now you're confusing me with all your free thinking. Can I go in there, do you think? Will I be allowed in?
Yeah, why not? Yeah.
no reason.
Watch me come bouncing straight out and land on my backside on the steps. Am I allowed to go in there?
I don't know. You'll have to ask.
Can I go in there and have a look around? I'm interested in everything from UFOs to cosmic and evolutionary evidence.
There you go.
Sounds very complicated. I think it'd give me a headache. Anybody experts on grails here?
No, just help us.
The real Holy Grail has to do with natural perfumery, and you have to come in.
You're now telling me the Holy Grail is in your perfume shop down the road.
That's it. So I want to put some of this on you.
Do you?
This is Sauvagier.
This is
a very sexy evening scent. And this is Chevalier. This is for men.
Covering me, that's for men.
Yeah, they're both for men.
Are they?
That's a day scent.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, they're really
so,
nice.
You think the Holy
Here's
Grail
some presents
is...
from us.
Thank you. It's very nice.
You're welcome. And here's some brochures. I'd be happy to talk to you about the Holy Grail if you want to come into the shop. Okay. I actually know quite a bit about it.
Clever lady. Thank you very much indeed. Wow, I'm going to run out of space in my bag for interesting things.
Away from the commercial hurly-burly, there is something spiritual about Glastonbury. Indeed, the Grail was supposed to have been brought here, to Wirreal Hill, by the man who helped to bury Christ, Joseph of Arimathea. Joseph used the chalice from the Last Supper to collect Christ's blood at the crucifixion. Legend has it that while he was here, Joseph stuck his staff into the ground in this exact spot, and that it sprouted into this tree, this actual one. They know that, they say, because this particular species has its origins in the Middle East, which is remarkable. Mind you, I have got one like it at home, and as far as I know, Joseph was never there with a grail. The legend then says that after his death, the grail was possibly hidden somewhere around Glastonbury Abbey. Well, this is it, the top of Wirreal Hill. And if you believe the stories, this place has one of the strongest connections with Joseph of Arimathea and the Grail, which he supposedly brought here. And when you arrive, it's, I'm disappointed, to be honest. I don't know what I expected, but there's nothing at all. Nothing. And that's kind of the way of it with this quest, all these stories. I mean, in this case, for every person you find that tells you Joseph was here with the Grail, you'll find somebody that tells you, nah, he never was. Doesn't make it any easier. I asked historian Geoffrey Ash if he believed Joseph brought the Grail to Glastonbury.
It's not impossible that he came here. There are all these stories that don't really stick together. It was never an official Christian relic by any means. And here at Glastonbury, they have the Chronicle. The Abbey gives you a long list of all the relics they had, every possible and impossible relic, but they never claimed to have the Grail.
Of course, there is an even better legend linking Glastonbury to the Holy Grail. King Arthur and his knights are among the most famous Grail questers. So could the stories I grew up with hold the answer?
Can we bring the Grail and Arthur and Glastonbury and Camelot, can we bring it all together in one?
Not very convincingly, because there are different stories in medieval romances and so forth, and they don't really converge. The Grail is not conceived in these stories anyway as it would actually have been. The actual cup of the Last Supper would have been something quite simple. As somebody realised in Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, the diabolist picks a beautiful cup, which is wrong. And it would, in fact, have been something quite plain. But in the stories, it is magnificent. It's jewelled, it shines, it hovers in the air. It's a supernatural object altogether. It's quite mistaken to equate it with a thing that you could actually find and put in a museum or anything like that.
In one phrase, what's the score?
In one phrase, there is no physical grail, no. As supposedly the vessel of the Last Supper, it would have been there at the time, and it's mentioned in the Bible, but there's no reason whatever to suppose that people kept it or carried it around or that it had magical properties as it has in the romances. The Grail is not a physical object.
Well, that's a bit of a bombshell. There's no Grail in Glastonbury. There never was. Geoffrey went on to tell me that, in fact, the ancient legends of the Grail in Glastonbury came largely from the poetry of Lord Tennyson in the 19th century. I've reached a point in this journey where I just can't cling anymore to the belief that the Grail is some sort of cup hidden somewhere in Britain. I don't think it is in Britain. I don't even think it's a cup anymore. I mean, it's clear from Tennyson that he made up the whole idea of a Grail as a cup hidden here in Glastonbury, for instance. And that's the thing, the stories and the storytellers are right at the centre of this and have been for centuries. Fact and fiction have become so intertwined because we love these stories and we embellish them. So this now isn't a search for a cup, it's a search for the truth. So pass I hostel, hall and grange. By bridge and ford, by park and pale, all armed I ride, whate'er betide, until I find the Holy Grail. It's from Tennyson, and now I know it was Tennyson who actually linked the knights to the Grail in Glastonbury.
It's almost as though we get the stories and legends that we demand, and it's the same with the Grail stories. We want there to be a Grail. We want to go looking for it. So we make up and embellish and develop stories about it. And then we pass them down and share them.
I've come to the British Library in London to meet Richard Barber, the expert on the Holy Grail in literature. It turns out that Tennyson and the Victorians based their Grail stories on a 15th century book called The Death of Arthur by Sir Thomas Malory. There is only one surviving copy of Malory's manuscript. Incredibly, it was found in 1934 by somebody rummaging in a cupboard in the library at Winchester College.
This is the manuscript they found in the cupboard.
This is what was found. And if we look at this page,
and you can see
there's Galahad, yeah. Lancelot.
There you are.
Camelot. Is there any mention of the Grail here? Obviously, I can't.
Yes. Well, in fact, you can see fairly well. There's Holy Grail, spelled G-R-A-Y-L-E.
So those appearances of the word are so key there.
Absolutely.
Now, once again, it doesn't say what it is.
No.
What is he
now,
saying it is?
Now, what Malory thinks it is, like Tennyson, only put it into a Roman Catholic context, the cup of the Last Supper. And it's missing the end, so we don't know how Malory actually ended in, but, you know, quite extraordinary.
It's
a real physical link to the Middle Ages.
It is, and just to stand next to the thing. And how like anything to do with the Grail Quest that the end should be missing. You can't quite pin it down.
Well, the point is that Malory actually says, he keeps saying, I've taken this from the French. I've drawn it briefly from the French.
So there's another source there.
There's another source, and the source are the big French romances.
The French romances, which Malory based his story on, all told different versions of the same Grail story, and they were a huge hit in medieval Europe.
So these stories being told and retold, where was the first reference of the Grail?
There's a writer called Chrétien de Troyes, and Troyes is in northern France, and he wrote it about the end of the 12th century, that's in the 1190s, 800 years ago, if you like.
So I've traced the Grail back to a story written in the 1190s by a French bloke called Chrétien de Troyes. I feel like I'm really getting close now to finding out why everyone thinks the Holy Grail is a cup. This is the medieval town of Troyes in the Champagne region of France. Chrétien wrote the first Grail story from here. His book is the original source for all the stories about the Grail as a cup. But where did he hear about it? In his book, a knight from King Arthur's court called Sir Percival comes across a mysterious castle where he finds a wounded lord called the Fisher King. During a feast there, a beautiful woman parades through the room with a magical cup called a Grail. Now, at this point, Percival is supposed to ask a crucial question. Whom does the Grail serve? Unfortunately, nobody's told Percival that, so he doesn't. And as a result, he's condemned to wander the land in an endless quest for the Grail. There is only one problem. Chrétien made the whole thing up.
Chrétien d'Artois' story of the Grail as an enchanted cup was the blockbuster, the big hit bestseller of its day. It was an enormous success. It went round the world, and that took some doing back then. And it survived. It's still taught as part of the curriculum in French schools today. But what I love is that this man whose stories inspired my childhood and whose stories spawned countless hundreds, probably thousands of tales and legends of myths about this marvellous magical cup is shrouded in mystery himself. We know very little about him. But we do know that his tale of the Grail as this wonderful chalice was just that, a tale, a story. He made it up.
So, another dead end. The Grail definitely isn't the cup from the Last Supper. But my quest continues because there's been another Grail bestseller recently. Just like Chrétien d'Artois' story, Dan Brown's book, The Da Vinci Code, has taken the world by storm. But it's left his readers wondering what's real and what's made up.
How many people know at any one time where the Holy Grail is hidden?
Four.
We've got the Grandmaster Jack Sonnier and the Three Seneschal, right?
Paris is the location for much of the action in Dan Brown's book. And now the city is gripped with Grail fever. Tourists are flocking here, but not to see the usual landmarks.
The bathroom that he goes to, you guys, is right above. You see where this bus is going through?
They're following a Grail trail laid out in the Da Vinci Code.
What does that stand for?
Madonna on the Rocks?
Yes, Madonna on the Rock.
It's Madonna of the Rocks. Madonna's on the Rocks is probably a drink.
If you don't want to know where Dan Brown thinks the Holy Grail is, you might want to look away now.
She rests at last beneath the starry skies. Oh. It's in glass. Voila, we've got it right here.
So, the Grail is in a shopping centre.
Basically.
It's just kind of a surprise, really.
Yeah.
Right.
It must say something about the power of the Grail story that 800 years after the first one, this modern-day Grail romance has sold over 30 million copies worldwide. But can it really help me on my quest? Simon Cox has written a book called Cracking the Da Vinci Code, which attempts to separate fact from fiction.
In the simplest terms, it's an airport novel that the guy gets the girl in the end, solves a mystery, and all's well with the world. But what he's done is he's lumped together all of these factual elements. So he's based it on two or three books that are popular alternative history books. And he's woven in these elements to it, if you like. He's now part of Grail folklore.
It is difficult to grasp just how big a phenomenon it is commercially. I mean, how much has it meant to you? How many books have you sold on the strength of it?
Well, I'm over a million.
Really?
Which, you know, we went into this, myself and the publishers, thinking 30,000, 40,000, so over a million. So that just goes to show, you know, and to be frank, it's fluff. It's an A to Z, it's just fluff. But it goes to show that people are, you know, they're so into this that they'll eat anything to do with it. They'll just eat it up. It's a bit surreal.
And one thing people have been eating up in their millions is Dan Brown's big idea. That the Holy Grail, or Saint Graal, isn't a cup. It's really Sang Real, the holy blood of Jesus.
The possibility that Mary Magdalene, this fallen woman of the Catholic Church, wasn't a fallen woman at all. She's Jesus' wife, and they possibly have a child, and that leads through to the idea that the bloodline itself is the Grail.
This is the Pantheon, built to commemorate France's greatest men. Many of them are buried here in the crypt. And some of them have been linked with the theory that Mary Magdalene married Christ and had children, a secret so powerful and important that it's been kept and guarded for centuries, supposedly by an underground organization called the Priory of Zion.
Now, some of the names of the people who are meant to have been leaders of that organisation include some of the greatest figures from history. Leonardo da Vinci, Isaac Newton, Victor Hugo. Victor's in here.
so he's not going to be much help to us on our quest. But sitting down here in this crypt, beneath this incredible huge mausoleum with the weight of history just pressing down on you, it's very easy to start to believe that the Grail, whatever it is somewhere here in France.
So, I'm off to pursue the Mary Magdalene and bloodline theory. It doesn't begin with Dan Brown's book. This theory has been around for a long time, and it's heavily linked with the south of France. In fact, many people refer to the area as Grail Country. So, that's where I'm heading.
This is the famous TGV, the train à grande vitesse, which means high-speed train, basically. The French reckon it's the fastest in the world. Mind you, the Japanese will tell you it's their bullet, but hey, it is quick. In everyday use, it'll hit 186 miles an hour, which is good, because I've got pretty much the whole of France to get across. It can go faster than that, though. In 1990, it set a world record at 320 miles an hour. And from 186 miles an hour, it would take 3 kilometres to come to a complete stop. I just know this stuff. This is weird. I'm upstairs on a train. It's very smooth, though. It's quite a sort of luxurious, rarefied atmosphere. They even ban mobile phones low to keep the noise down, so you don't disturb the other passengers. It's quite posh.
I thought we were the fastest.
Is Carcassonne, the only walled medieval city still lived in today. 100 people have their homes here. 3 million people visit it every year. It's a World Heritage Centre. Now, there have been settlements in this place for 2,500 years, and back in 1209, it was a stronghold of the Cathars, a group of heretics based in this part of the south of France.
The Cathars practiced an alternative form of Christianity. They believed in two gods, which put them in direct opposition to the beliefs of the Roman Catholic Church. The church sent an armed crusade south to destroy them. According to legend, the Cathars were the protectors of the secret that the Grail was a holy bloodline, the Sang Real.
It was the summer of 1209, and massed outside these enormous city walls were the Catholic crusaders of Simon de Montfort, laying siege. Inside were crammed Cathar refugees from throughout the surrounding countryside, and it was getting desperate. They were running out of supplies and food. They had no choice. And on the 15th of August, they surrendered. It was the end for the Cathars in Carcassonne, but the beginning of a bloody Catholic crusade that would last for decades.
Over the next 35 years, the Cathars were chased across southern France and almost wiped out, until only a few remote strongholds remained.
I'm in the Pyrenees, just north of the Spanish border, and this is the heart of Cathar country. I've even got an authentic horse. This is very stubborn,
Frémus, he's an Ariège horse, indigenous to the area. This is just the sort of thing they might have ridden on the way to their remote strongholds. In fact, it would have been probably the only way of getting there. And that's where I'm going now. In fact, not to one of their remote strongholds, but to probably the stronghold. That one over there, Montségur. So the Cathars believed in a god.
Yes, they did. Actually, they believed in two gods, you know, yeah. A good and an evil god. The evil god was the one that had created the world, created matter. So it was the god of the Old Testament. So the Cathars, in fact, were saying the church, in also obeying the Old Testament, was worshipping the wrong god.
That's a pretty fundamental disagreement to have with the church, isn't it?
Absolutely. And then you add to that, they didn't think Jesus Christ was divine. They thought Jesus Christ was a messenger. He was an emissary, but he wasn't God.
So hence the fury from the Catholics.
Right, and they already thought that the Catholic Church was a fraud. And the popes were, of course, aghast, and they tried for 50 years to organize a crusade to get the northerners from France and Germany to come down here and eliminate Catholicism.
Because the northerners had big armies that would do that
right.
And a Catholic.
And in the end, it was the most powerful pope of the Middle Ages, Innocent III, who finally managed to get a crusade to come down here in 1209. Their first stop was at a town called Béziers on the Mediterranean. They broke into the town. There were only about 2,000 Cathars there. But they killed everyone, 20,000 people. The story goes that when they broke into the town, somebody came back and asked the archbishop who was leading the crusade, well, how do we tell Cathars from Catholic? And he's supposed to have said, kill them all. God will know his own. So 20,000 people were killed. It was the beginning of a crusade that lasted 20 years. Thousands killed, and it culminated here. The last hideout of the Cathars, Montségur.
And that's the hideout we're going to now.
That's right.
Crikey.
There were 200 Cathars holed up in here, of which only 98 were warriors. But for months on end, they held off an army of 10,000 Catholic crusaders. Eventually, against overwhelming odds, Montségur fell.
So after a 10-month siege, the defenders of Montségur surrendered, and they were given terms. They could recant their faith, or they could burn. And not one recanted his faith. So 200 people were brought down from the top of Montségur and burned in a field.
It's an incredible story. But what about this theory that the Grail wasn't, you know, a cup, but it was a secret, and that secret was that Jesus married Mary Magdalene? Now, the Cathars are linked with that because some people say that the Cathars believe that, and that's where they come in with the Grail.
Yes, there is a line of thought saying that the Cathars actually knew that Jesus was a man, that he was a king, and that they had his skeleton. Mary Magdalene, his wife, was supposed to have sailed with his body to the south of France. And it was a secret, it was a treasure that was held for hundreds of years. And that the Cathars, having the body of Christ, were the ultimate heretics because they proved that he had not been resurrected. They had the Holy Grail, which meant the sang royal, or the holy blood. The holy bloodline was meant by the Holy Grail.
So does the theory stand up?
Well, it requires great leaps of faith that in the treasury of the Cathars there was such an object. It requires believing that Mary Magdalene came here, that it was hidden for 1,000 years before all of a sudden Catharism arose once again. I'm more of a rationalist, even though this is a very spiritual and spooky place, that I think it's doubtful that the Holy Grail was here.
There is evidence, however, that the Cathars smuggled some sort of treasure out before they surrendered. Whatever it was hidden somewhere beneath these mountains. This region has drawn grail hunters for centuries, and it's easy to see why.
I've done a few thousand miles on this journey now, and what I've discovered is that every time you think you're getting close to the truth about the grail, it moves on. It's so alluring and tempting. It just leads you on. And I think that's because the grail legend seems to have entangled itself with just about all the really good, exciting stories through history. It just pops up every time. But what that does is turn a journey like this
into something closer to a proper old-fashioned Grail quest, because it's full of adventure and discovery and tales along the way. Just as you knock down one story about the Grail, another one pops up to tempt you along.
Which brings us to the Nazis and the Holy Grail. In 1933, a book called Crusade Against the Grail brought the link between the Cathars and the Grail to public attention. It was written by a prominent Nazi called Otto Rahn. Of course, he didn't actually say what the Grail was, but his readers decided that it was part of the Cathar treasure and that it was hidden somewhere here in Cathar country, quite possibly in a cave just like this one. It may not be the most scholarly of references, but in Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, the Nazis go looking for the Holy Grail. Now, that's based on a belief in popular culture that Hitler really did send people out looking for the Grail. So, did Hitler search for the Grail? What we do know is that someone once heard Hitler talking about it, but there's no evidence to suggest he actually sent anyone looking for the Grail, here or anywhere else. So much for Indiana Jones. One of the most intriguing stories about the Grail concerns a priest and a tiny mountaintop hamlet called Rennes-le-Château. It was about 100 years ago, and he was just a very ordinary, really quite impoverished priest, until, whilst he was renovating his church, he found something mysterious. And overnight, he became very wealthy. Now, whatever it was he found is supposedly linked directly to the Grail, maybe even holding the key to the secret of the Grail itself. So, Rennes-le-Château is where I'm going to find out more. Wow. The little church in Rennes-le-Château is dedicated to Mary Magdalene. The theory that she had children with Jesus and then came to live in this part of France was the subject of another best-selling book, The Holy Blood and the Holy Grail, in which the Grail is said to be the Holy Bloodline, no, or Sang Real.
It's right, but it's obviously it's still in need of some rest.
But of course, this is a Grail quest, and so inevitably there are several theories about what the priest found to make him wealthy. Local resident Karen McDermott explains to me.
The first theory here, he started his renovations and he found something. And there are then various theories as to what he found. Was it documents? Was it treasure? Was it something so important that people paid him to be quiet about it?
Really? Like hush money, basically?
Like hush money, yes. So that's theory number one. Theory number two is actually someone knew there was something here and they paid him to find it. And he subsequently did find it. And the third theory is that he didn't find anything at all. And he actually raised all his money, and he raised a lot of money, by selling masses illegally. It's a crime, if you like, in the Catholic Church called simony.
What about the good, simple one?
That he found treasure.
Dug something up that was worth a fortune.
Well, in the context of the Grail, we need to look at the word treasure in a very abstract sense. That it wasn't a pot of gold. That it was information. And I think this is where we come back to, if not hush money, him having some very privileged knowledge that somehow, either because he had found, let's say, in the wildest possible dreams, he had found the grave of Jesus and Mary Magdalene, he attracted donations from a lot of people, important people and influential people who wanted to keep that quiet.
What the priest found is still the subject of much debate. Some people claim that it was two ancient parchments and that they might unlock the secret of the Sang Real as a holy bloodline, that Mary Magdalene and Christ were married and established a line of descendants.
The only concrete thing seems to be the parchments, the real physical thing that were found.
Yes, these we have and we can look at.
And these are copies?
These are copies. And if you look at the lettering closely, some of the letters are typed slightly above the line. For example, the very last line, M-O-R-T.
Yeah, you really can see that.
Yes, being the word for death. And the message hidden here in French, to Dagobert II, king, and to Zion, is the treasure, and it is death, or it is their dead. There's a little bit of disagreement about the translation.
So you've got supposedly ancient parchments with a hidden code, talking about Zion and death and treasure.
Yes.
That sounds pretty fantastic. I mean, are these genuine?
Well,
what do you think? What do people think?
Some people think they're genuine, yes. Some people have constructed their entire careers and their books on these parchments being genuine. Other people, more recently, have looked at, for example, the version of the Bible that this was taken from. This is a passage from the Bible. And, for example, have concluded that it's taken from an 1898 Bible.
Ah.
So just how old can it be?
That would rather undermine the idea than being particularly old.
As opposed to 13th century, which other people have argued.
This place is incredible. Apparently it's been attracting grail hunters for decades, but there are even signs in the village saying no digging. People have just been pitching up here and trying to dig stuff up. But you can kind of see the attraction. It's just full of mysteries. Saunier and his money, I mean, the three main theories about how he made it, you can't discount for certain any of them. I mean, some reckon maybe he did it by selling masses. Well, there is some evidence to suggest that he did, but you can't discount that he was in the pay of somebody to find something here. In fact, the only thing you can say about this place for certain is that it's not surprising that a village of just 50 people continues to manage to attract hundreds of thousands of visitors every year. I'm nearing the end of my quest. I've followed so many stories to dead ends. It's time to visit the one organisation that's been linked to the Grail for 2,000 years. It's time to head to Rome and the Vatican for an audience with the Pope. Well, not an audience as such.
I've come round the back of the Pope's house. Seriously, this is his backyard. He lives just up there, but that's not what I'm here for. I'm going through there to his secret archive. This is it. Just the other side of these doors is the Vatican secret archive. Now, for hundreds of years, nobody was allowed in here at all from outside the Vatican, but recently they have let in a few select scholars. And incredibly, I've been granted permission to go in, but it is so secret, nobody can come in and film me looking. So I'm on my own. Wish me luck.
The Vatican's secret archive really is every bit as exciting as it sounds. For a start, it's huge. They reckon there's some 30 miles of shelves on which are kept some of the most astonishing historical documents. Things like, well, King Henry VIII, he petitioned the Pope to have his marriage to Catherine of Aragon annulled, and that petition is kept in here. We're talking about seriously important stuff. So if there are any original documents concerning the secret of the Holy Blood or Sang Real, the odds are they'll be in here. The closest I came to the Grail was a handwritten scroll that's nearly 700 years old and was the confessions that had been squeezed, shall we say, out of seven Templar heretics by the Catholic Church. So it's relevant to our story, but I'm told there's nothing specifically in it about the Holy Grail.
In fact, I couldn't find anything about the Grail in the whole archive, but that's the problem because, as I understand it, amazing as the collection is, some of it isn't catalogued, and bits of it have disappeared completely down the centuries. So basically, who knows what's in there?
It was time to do some interrogation of my own.
Cute.
I wanted to find out what the church had to say about the Holy Bloodline, or Sang Real theory. Fortunately, Father Gerald O'Collins, an eminent professor of theology, was more than happy to cough up.
The idea that the Holy Grail means holy blood in that sense is just phony from a scholarly point of view. It was a later explanation. The word grail was going around at the beginning, and then they called it the Holy Grail, but it has nothing to do with sangreal.
The conspiracy theorists make a lot of their myths that Mary Magdalene was married to Jesus. Some of them will say they believe that the church knows things about the grail and keeps secrets. There is this air of secrecy about it. Why do people claim that? Why do people claim
it? It sells well. It sells very well. The official church is supposed to have suppressed that, but it's fantasy. It's pure fantasy. There simply is no evidence of a liaison between Mary Magdalene and Jesus. I mean, it's just not there. It's not even there in the so-called apocryphal Gospels, the ones that were made up later. They talk about Mary Magdalene there, but there's no evidence that Jesus was married to her or had a sexual relationship with her. No evidence that there were children. I mean, that is modern fabrication. It's good stuff for novels, and it's spicy and so on, but it degrades the real Mary Magdalene, and it simply is unfounded historically.
It turns out that the big secret the church was supposed to have been hiding for centuries, that the secret of the Holy Grail, or Sang Real in French, really meant Sang Real, or Holy Blood, was all down to a dodgy translation by a 15th century English writer called John Harding. Thanks a lot, John. Nice one.
So I'm nearing the end of my quest. It's been 2 weeks, 5,000 miles, and a quick dash through hundreds of years of history. And I'm going home empty-handed. But I really didn't expect to come home bearing a bejeweled chalice anyway. I'm not that stupid. And it looks like the whole concept of the Grail as a cup was a literary invention. In fact, I don't believe the Grail was ever an object. Maybe the conspiracy theorists were right, maybe there is a bloodline, but I don't think that's it either. I think the Grail story has survived through the centuries because we want it to. We're endlessly fascinated with this idea of an infinitely special, infinitely precious, and ultimately unattainable ideal. And so we've woven it into our favourite stories, folklore, legend, myth, and history. Maybe Chrétien de Troyes, the guy who wrote the original stories inventing the Grail as a cup, was right when he told his tales of chivalrous knights doing heroic deeds on their brave Grail quests. Grail questing isn't about finding answers. It's about asking good questions. It's not what you find. It's how you go about trying to find it. So does the Grail exist? Jury's out. Is it worth looking for? Oh, yes.
Well, you might have read the book or seen the film, but is The Da Vinci Code the greatest story ever sold? That's over on BBC Four now. Next here on BBC One, Sonia and Naomi reach Breaking Point in EastEnders.
Yeah, and you think it's where? What island? Bardsey Island. And that's where? Wales?